Sorry.
It's the I don't want to be in the equal moral basis as our neighbors, but for 2.5 years there is shelling from across the Jordanian border, and civilians, our children, are in shelters, living in shelters for 2.5 years. I haven't seen nor read nor heard that the world was so horrified.
Do you consider you're on a superior moral basis to the Arabs?
I think yes. I'm not happy to say that, because we intend to remain in this neighborhood. And we want, we're convinced that the day of peace will come, and we want to cooperate with them. And when there will be peace, I think there will be no difference.
And Prime Minister, Egyptian kids are taught to hate Israel. Aren't you, in fact, driving the lesson home to them?
That's the beginning of their hatred?
No, but it drives, it endorses it, doesn't it?
But do you believe that we wanted to hurt their fathers or their mothers, whoever were in the factories? Let me tell you a story that I only heard yesterday, which is typical. In one of our kibbutzim right across the Jordan, that has been shelled day and night, and there are children there that don't know any other home except air shelters. And at one of the shelling, the father with a little boy of four was in the shelter, and the child was scared and cried. And the father said, "Look, don't worry, these are not the shells from the other side, these are our shells." And the child said, "Do they have shelters for the children on the other side?" He said, "Because, you know, the children are not to blame that their fathers are Fatah. Our children are not taught to hate."
Mrs. Mayor, I mean, if it was business, nobody makes a profit without risk, and the profit that you are going to make here is peace. Isn't it worth some risk for a short period?
We think enough of our people have been killed for no reason whatsoever. And I refuse to believe that this is something that only we can profit by it. As long as people believe that peace is something, some kind of luxury that the Israelis have gotten into their minds, that that's what they would like to have. And therefore, if they want this luxury, they have to pay for it.
Prime Minister, you always talk about direct negotiations with the Arabs. But what possible incentive for the Arabs to sit down at a table with you when everybody you speak to in Israel conveys the impression that you're there to stay on the Golan Heights, in Jerusalem, even on the West Bank? Why should they sit down? What are they going to get?
What do we say? We say no preconditions. Let's sit down and negotiate. And we say Israel wants secure and agreed borders.
But you go throughout the territories that you conquered in 67, Mrs. Mayor, and you find Israel digging in a very permanent way. What possible reason have the Arabs to think that you really intend to go for many of them?
People say to us, pull back to the borders of 67, and then there will be peace. We were in the borders of 67, in June in 67, and in May 67. Why was there war? And immediately after the war, we said, let us sit down and negotiate peace. They didn't do it. And we say now, we've been saying it over and over again, let us sit down and negotiate a peace which we say will be an attempt to have agreed borders.
No preconditions, not even Jerusalem?
We say no preconditions before we sit down. Nasser will also come with some ideas, and we will come with some ideas, of course we will. I don't say that when we sit down at the table, we have nothing to negotiate for. Nasser will have nothing to negotiate for.
Has there been a single moment since 1967 when you thought that the Arabs were ready to talk?
No. Because this is something that must be realized by people in the world, and unless they realize that, there is no understanding of the entire situation. This Their quarrel with the Arabs is not a quarrel for a piece of land. It's not for territory. It's not for anything concrete. They just refuse to believe that we have the right to exist at all.
But surely for the people who were here in 48, who have left then, surely for the Jordanians who are now on the other side of the Jordan, surely for them it's land. And don't you understand them and their desire to come back?
Why did they leave?
Well, many of them were refugees of war. Maybe they don't like a conquered army.
But who made the war? They don't like a conquered army. Therefore, we should leave. Oh, that I understand. Yes, then we can have peace in this area.
But without
Israel in this area, there won't be peace. The Arabs are not so friendly with each other. But that's none of my business. Oh, this is a solution.
But I have a feeling.
It just happens that there are 14 Arab countries and immense territories. And we've come back. We've been here before.
2,000 years ago.
And we've come back.
2,000 years ago.
Yes. What did we take away from the Arabs when we came back? We didn't want to live with them in peace. We asked them to leave. We didn't accept the partition of Mr. Churchill in 1922 and the partition of the UN in 1947. We didn't say yes. What difference is there between Arabs who were on this side of the Jordan and the other side of the Jordan, Arabs in the East Bank and the west of the border of the West Bank? I mean, when were Palestinians born? What was all this area before the First World War? When Britain got the mandate over Palestine, what was Palestine then? Palestine was then the area between the Mediterranean and the Iraqi border.
You say there is no such thing
East
as
East and West Bank? No. East and West Bank was Palestine. I'm a Palestinian. From 21 until 48, I carried a Palestinian passport. There was no such thing in this area as Jews and Arabs and Palestinians. There were Jews and Arabs.
You deny that there was a Palestine Arab people before, but there is now a Palestine liberation movement. The history of liberation movements are that they grow. Won't this one grow and become, in fact, your biggest enemy?
I don't say there are no Palestinians, but I say there is no such thing as a distinct Palestinian people of all the Palestinians who live in Jordan. Why have the Palestinians in the West Bank become more Palestinians since the 5th of June 67 than they were before? Why didn't they set up a Palestinian country in addition to Jordan? Supposing your premise is right, then what should they have done? They should have set up another independent Palestine and fought from there. They didn't do that. They adopted the fact that they are in Jordan. They've adopted the Jordanian citizens. They are the majority in Jordan. They are in parliament. They are in government. What has happened since? Why have they become more Palestinian conscious since the war of 67? People, decent people, liberal people, people that are for self-determination, sympathize with Palestinians. Everybody has the right to self-determine except we. We're the only people in the world to whom it is not given the rights to for self-determination. We have to be, evidently, minorities all over the world, and we have no right for independence. The Arabs are prepared to negotiate with us? Which Arab? Where? When? If you know of an Arab leader, head of state, that wants to negotiate with us, by all means, tell us. I'm prepared to go to Cairo, I'm prepared to go to Damascus, I'm prepared to go to Amman, I'm prepared to go to Beirut, anywhere.
You would go to these places?
Yes, happily. To negotiate peace, of course.
What would be your first words to President Nasser if you did ever sit at the table with him?
I would say shalom to means peace.
Prime Minister, do you believe that if Nasser falls, you'll get anything better in his place?
Something we don't speculate about. I don't remember exactly that we have had a voice in putting Nasser in where he is. And it's not our business, nor within our power, to put him out and to put somebody else in.
Don't you believe that
all
you're
right, I believe sir? Is that it can't be worse. No matter who comes in his place, it can be worse.
One notices in this country that people never forget the war, that they listen to every news bulletin, every hour on the hour. You, of course, presumably know the news beforehand. Can you tell me how this affects you?
First place, my first choice would be not to be a prime minister. My second choice would be to be a prime minister in the same position as all other prime ministers who have their troubles, I'm sure, and have their difficulties. How does it affect? I'm one of our people that every boy that is wounded on the canal or somewhere else is a wound in the hearts of all of us. Don't necessarily have to know him or his family. It's difficult. And that's why we value life, not only our own. Just we value life. And this is our strength. Maybe one can say this is our weakness because the Arab leaders are not so sensitive to the very question of life, of having people alive instead of dead. Otherwise, there would be no wars.
Do you ever doubt the correctness of your policy?
No, sir. What do you mean, my policy? My policy is to keep our people alive and to keep our independence. How can anybody doubt the right that we have that is similar to the right of 125 peoples in the world?
Do you ever sometimes feel that perhaps you might just have stayed in America and been happier and lived a nicer life?
I didn't run away from America. America was kind to me and to my parents. I was brought up there. I enjoyed everything that the United States can give. But I never, never regretted for one second that I didn't remain there and that I came here.
But if you were brought up in America, what possible right have you to live in a land that was once Arab, whether he neglected it and left it a stony desert or not?
I came to Mojave when there was nothing there. This land was deserted for centuries. We were driven out of this land. Is this where history begins? Twice we were driven out of this land, occupied by other powers. The Arabs, this is the only people, the Jewish people, whose life, independence, dignity depends on this piece of soil. The only people in the world, not the Arabs. They have this entire territory, the entire vast area, 14 independent countries.
Isn't time, though, on their side, whatever you do?
Why?
Because they talk of fighting for 100 years, they talk of their population growing. Isn't time on their side?
I don't believe it. You mean they want me to believe that things will never change, that they will go on shooting and killing? You want me to believe that generation after generation of young people in the Arab countries will have no other ideal except to kill Jews? I don't believe it.
You are hopeful.
I'm positive that this will not happen. I don't know how long this war will go on.
Prime Minister, thank you very much.
Thank you.